Then there are some rules with this identifier. These are called identifier because it is used to identify something. I'll talk about that in this chapter only, that is identifiers and keywords. Right now just understand that num1 and num2, you can write any names, right? Now I have to tell my computer that what is the kind of these numbers. I am going to add two integer numbers over here, so I am writing int space num1 and int space num2, right? So that's how my computer would know that num1 is of type integer and num2 is also of type integer. And when I am adding two integer numbers, the result will be integer only. So that's why I have to take result which will store the addition of num1 and num2, which will also be having type int, right? So what is the syntax over here? Data type space identifier, right? Here identifier is num1, here identifier is num2, here identifier is result, right? Instead of this, you can also write int num1 comma num2 comma result, and then at the end semicolon. So in general, you can also write something as data type identifier 1, identifier 2, comma. You can separate it using comma until the last one and then semicolon. You can also write this. Now, what is the value of this number? Whenever I am writing int num1, what exactly is being done in your memory? In your memory, kind of box is created, kind of space is allocated. Imagine that you are having one box which is labeled as num1. You are having second box which is having label num2, and you are having third box which is having label result. You are having three boxes. Right now, inside these boxes, there is no value, or say garbage value is there. No particular value is there. Now, if you want to add the numbers, you have to tell the computer that what are these numbers? What is the value inside these boxes? Right? So there are two ways to give this value. First way is compile time, and second way at runtime. What exactly is the meaning of compile time? If I am writing num1 equal to 10 and num2 equal to 2 over here, that means I am telling in the program itself that what are these numbers. That is called compile time, right? So here I have already told my computer that num1 is 10 and num2 is 2. You have to add them and get the result and print the result, right? This is the first way. In second way, I am not adding this over here. I am just writing num1 and num2, and whenever I am running my program, I am executing my program, and you can see that black screen. In that black screen, I am entering the number. That is called runtime. Currently, for easiness, I am just using compile time. So I am giving num1 as 10 and num2 as 2, which is called initialization, right? That is called initialization, right? After that, I have defined, or I have declared result. Whatever I have written, data type space identifier, is called declaration. So I have declared num1 here, I have declared num2 here, and I have declared result over here. I am going to use three identifiers or three variables, and that's why I have to write it for the I have to write declaration for three times. Now, what is result? Result equal to num1 and num2. In initial stage of programming, what students do wrongly, they used to initialize result also. They used to write 12 over here. This is wrong, because if I am giving result the value at compile time only, then what is the aim of this program? I am writing this program to get the result by using programming, not by using my mind, right? So I have to find the result using some equations, not by directly writing the answer. So that's why you don't do this thing. Don't initialize the result. Result can be obtained only after the addition of num1 and num2. Suppose you have taken result 2 equal to num1 minus num2, then you have to write in result 2 over here, right? So whatever variable you are using, you have to declare it first. Right now I'm just considering the addition, so that's why I'm just erasing this. So what do you think? Just pause the video, just think of it. Do my result will be printed on the screen? Just save the program, name it as sum, compile the program and execute. Will it print something on the black screen? No. Let's see. Run. Nothing is printed. Why? Do you have any answer why? Just think of it and then just proceed to the program or the video. Nothing is printed because I have not used printf statement. So what exactly is done till this code? First, I have written int num1 equal to 10. So one box is created which is labeled as num1, and inside that box I have put value 10. After that, I have written int num2 equal to 2. So another box is created. Inside that box I have put 2 and labeled this as num2. Then third box is created, result, which is labeled as result, but right now there is no value inside that box. Here, when it encountered this statement, in which I have written that the value of inside result is equal to the value inside num1 and the value inside num2. So what will be the value inside num1? 10. What will be the value inside num2? 2. So addition of both of this will be put on the third box, which is result. So now my result box is contained value 12, but it will not be printed because I have not commanded my computer to print so. So that's why I have to return printf statement, which is having this this syntax. In the round braces I am doing imported code. Now what do you think? If I write result, will result printed on the screen or 12 printed on the screen? Just think of it. If I just save this program, I compile it and then run it, you can see result is printed, not the value inside that. What I want to be printed is the value inside the result, not the result, right? So this is the difference. Whenever, just make sure that you know, whenever I am writing something in between the inverted comma, it will be printed as it is. Here, if I write comal, it will be printed. This is something like hello world or good morning program that I have performed previously, right? So this is something like this. If I am compiling it and running it, it will print comal. There is no sign of my value 12 over here. So I have to tell my computer that inside this inverted comma, you have to print the value inside the box, not the label of the box or the identifier. How can you tell the computer? By using some syntax that you have to remember, that is percentage and %d. Here I have used the data type int for result, that's why I am writing percentage %d. If I have used float data type for result, then I have to write f. Whatever I want to print, which data type it is carrying, based on that it will be decided that what is the value inside this, right? So here, as I am using int, I can write percentage %d. Percentage will be same, but the alphabet after that will change. Don't worry about this thing. I'll give you the notes based on this, that what alphabet you should use with which data type, right? So printf. Now here, when computer encounter this inside inverted comma, it will know that it have to print the value inside the label, not the label itself. And what is this label or identifier? That I'm going to write after comma, result. So what is the syntax mean? Result, you have to put value of result over here, right? So let me just save this program, compile it and run it. You can see 12 is printed, not the result, right? What students used to do, they used to write this result inside the inverted comma. That is wrong. Now another way to write this is the addition of num1 and num2 is percentage %d. What would you think will be written? So this string will be written as it is, but when the my computer knows that here percentage %d is used, it will print the value. Whose value? Value after this comma, result. So if I just save this program, and compile it and run it, you can see the addition of num1 and num2 is 12, right? So this is the magic of C programming language. Now my task for you guys is to just pause this video and instead of this num1 and num2, the value 10 and 2 must be printed. Like say, it should be printed like the addition of 10 and 2 is 12. That should be the output. Now, some of the students can do the addition of 10 and 2. I don't want to write this, right? So, do not do the task as I shown you. Don't do it like that. I want that the value of num1 is printed over here. So instead of 10, if I am writing 11, you should not change something over here. How I can write that? So just pause the video, think of it. You can also execute it in your C++ and then come back to the video and see the solution. So the solution for that is, instead of num1, I can tell my computer that you use %d. As num1 is of type integer, I am writing %d for num1, and for this also %d. Now I have to maintain the sequence that first d I want to print the value of num1, second d I want to print value of num2, and for third d I want to print the value of result. So this is how you can print something. Just save the program, compile it and run it. You can see the addition of 10 and 2 is 12. Now if I just change anything, if I am writing 1110 over here, save the program, execute, compile it and execute it, you can see the addition of 110 and 2 is 112. So what I wanted you to do is you do not need to change anything over here. So don't write 10 and 2 over here. What I need to make your program more dynamic. So this is how you can do. Make sure that you maintain the sequence of these labels, because if you change the sequence, the output will be changed. Suppose I am swapping num1, num2 over here. And if I just compile and run the program, you can see the addition of 2 and 110 is 112, right? So this is how you can write a program to add two numbers. In the upcoming lectures, I'm going to talk about the scanf part, which allows you user to say, suppose I'm running it, here it can ask you that what numbers you want to add, so which allows user to add values runtime. So this is how you can perform this program. The homework task for you guys is to make a calculator. In the calculator, you can do addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. Try to perform this program by yourself. If it is not done by you, I'll make sure that you understand that in your lab lecture. I hope you enjoy this class. If you have any doubt, you can comment below the comment section. You can ask me personally too during the live classes. And I'll make sure that I clear your doubt. Okay, thank you so much.